Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for coming so much. We're running a couple minutes late due to the weather and other stuff, but we are here and ready to go. We are all particularly excited about our next guests. We've been excited about all our guests, but these guests in particular. Well, this is a conversation with Mr. Nicholas Payton and Miss Melissa A. Weber. Now, Melissa A. Weber is a stalwart personality here in New Orleans. We love her particularly because she has a superhero alter ego known as DJ Soul Sister. And she spins some great radio discs. Now, forgive me, I'm dating myself. CDs on WWOZ. And she's been doing that for 25 years, y'all. Give it up for that. In addition, she's now the executive curator at the Hogan Jazz Archive here in New Orleans. Make some noise. Yes, indeedy. Yes, indeedy. So, you know, we're getting scholarship forever now. It's fabulous, fabulous. And of course, our musical guest, the fabulous stalwart, multi-instrumentalist, Grammy Award-winning trumpeteer, artist, composer, Mr. Nicholas Payton. Make some noise, y'all. Yes, they have entered the stage. Thank you.
All right, good afternoon, everybody. You know, I think it's great that this conversation that we're about to have follows the previous one of Matt Sacchini, in which he discussed Louis Armstrong as a revolutionary and not just someone who followed tradition, but created tradition and created innovations. And in that way, Nicholas Payton follows in that line. And we're going to talk about that today. We're going to talk about Louis Armstrong. We're going to talk about you. And first of all, you have some open.
First of all, let's talk about director, curator. What's your position at Hogan?
Oh, curator. Cur-
the new curator at the Hogan Jazz Archives at Tulane University.
Well, thank you. I really want to give thanks to Dr. Bruce Rayburn, who has led the effort over the past several years at Hogan. And, you know, so many researchers are indebted to him. I'm thrilled to continue in that. But let's talk about you.
Okay.
So, Louis Armstrong, how are you introduced to Louis Armstrong? What's your intro to Louis?
Wow, I don't remember not knowing about Louis Armstrong, really. I mean, growing up here in New Orleans and having musicians as parents, he was just always a part of the lexicon. However, quite admittedly, I didn't really get into him until much later in my development. I mean, I started playing trumpet when I was 4, but it wasn't really until I was like maybe 15, 16, until I saw the value and like took him seriously. Quite honestly, I thought of him to be an Uncle Tom, like the whole imagery of him with the handkerchief and smiling and stuff like that didn't really sit well with me initially. And it was because of someone who I did look up to very much, pulling my coattail to his work. It was Wynton Marsalis. He was like, man, you should check out Pops. The funny thing is that people assumed that I already had. But then when I started like really listening and shed my my outlook on him, I was like, wow, this cat playing a lot of trumpet. You know, this is a bad MF. And I just instantly took to it, and to the point of which, like, people often called me like the second coming or whatever. Like, there was just a simpatico there in terms of my looks, in terms of my stage presence. Even at that time, you know, I often play and I held my horn up to the sky, which was not something that was too much in favor at the time. Even like trumpeters like Wynton and like Terrence Blanchard, if you look at early videos of them in the 80s, everyone was playing down to the ground like Miles, and Pops was playing up to the sky almost like to God or something. And it was just something about that clarion, regal thing about the trumpet. And Pops was really the embodiment of that. Really, he put the trumpet on the map. I don't think people really understand that. The trumpet as an instrument, because even his earliest recordings, he played cornet. A lot of the early literature for that style of brass was in cornet. All of the method books, like the Clark, Arban's, they were all for cornet. In fact, there's a... a letter. Ricky, you might know. Did Clark write Benj? You know what I'm talking about? Okay, well, there's a letter. And let me pull this up right now. Sorry. Sorry.
The new way.
Okay, so Herbert L. Clark wrote Benj, basically warning him of the perils of the trumpet. It was like the devil's music, and it was associated with jazz, the nearest hell, he called it, and I quote, and saying like we should, like, we can't go this route of the trumpet, because the trumpet at that time was not viewed as a legitimate instrument. It was in classical music, which was viewed as the legitimate music. It was only used in maybe short orchestral passages, clarion piece where you want, like, you know, some kind of heralding of some sort. But it was not viewed as something to be played seriously. Louis Armstrong was the one who took that instrument single-handedly and made that instrument valid in the 20th century. All the literature before that was cornet, even his earlier records. And that really came to home when I took some lessons with Vincent Chickowitz, who was second trumpet to Adolph Bud Herseth, who was the first trumpet in the Chicago Brass. And the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, their brass section in the 50s on, they were looked at as the gold standard for brass playing, certainly in like the American classical tradition. And Chickowitz, my teacher, and Herseth, his buddy, the first trumpet, said, "We look to Pops to define the sound." So here are two classical musicians who, like, classical music is viewed as legitimate music, and this jazz, black music, is the devil's music, according to Clark. They're looking to him to define the sound of what the trumpet is. So not only within the traditions of black music, Louis Armstrong did define the sound of what the trumpet was, but he defined the sound of what the trumpet was for all of us globally, period. So when you hear that sound, when you hear a trumpet blaring or whatever, I mean, we hear legends of Buddy Bolden, but unfortunately we don't have the documentation. This master, Louis Armstrong, he is the standard of what the trumpet sounds like right now. So whenever you hear a trumpet player playing somewhere or whatever, we all owe an incredible debt to Louis Armstrong.
And you cited, you mentioned that there have been many comparisons that people have made between you and Louis Armstrong over the years. And one that comes to mind is trumpeter Doc Cheatham, who you collaborated with for a Grammy-winning album in 1997. And he was 90, 91 years old, and he said that you were the closest to Louis Armstrong that he had ever heard. Talk about how you feel your direct influence is of Louis Armstrong and why Doc Cheatham, a legend, would feel that way.
I don't know why he said that, but it felt good to hear, certainly. I mean, he knew Louis Armstrong. He was in Chicago in the 20s when Pops was up there, like, changing the face of music as we know it. And he really... Pops and King Oliver embraced him. In fact, they were the only musicians, according to what he told me, who were nice to him. All the other cats in Chicago kind of vibed him. He would sub gigs for them. And he actually had a mute that he used to use, a straight mute that Oliver gave him, that he played with on up to the point, you know, to the end, really. So he really always had, a love for New Orleans before that, but certainly due to the New Orleans cats and Pops and Oliver specifically, and that started his love affair with New Orleans on up to the end of his life. In fact, that was the how we bonded. I was on a cruise ship in the late 80s, I guess maybe like 89, I was playing with the great Clark Terry in a group he had called the Tempestuous Trumpeters. And
how old were you about this?
I was like 16. And it was like four of us, me, this cat Ryan Kaiser, who plays with Lincoln Center, Greg Gisbert, and another cat, Rod Magaha. And so we were on this cruise ship for like a week. I saw that Doc Cheatham was playing. And I really didn't know much about him, but it was like, yeah, you know, let me check this legend out. You know, and I went to the place where he was playing and listened to a set. I was pretty shy at the time, but I mustered up the courage to go talk to him. And I said, hey, Mr. Cheatham, I'm Nicholas Payton. I'm from New Orleans. And his eyes lit up, and he just started telling me all these stories about Louis Armstrong and King Oliver. And he had never heard me play a note, and he invited me up on the first song to play the next set, and I played the whole set with him. And that was the beginning of a relationship from 89 to his passing for like almost 10 years. That we had, you know, culminating in an album. Mm-hmm.
And another album that you did, Dear Lewis, in 2001, featuring your interpretations of Louis Armstrong songs. Tell us about that.
Yeah, that was interesting because, you know, as I stated earlier, when I came on the scene, there was this kind of media blitz that was like, billing me as the next second coming of Louis Armstrong, which felt good in some sense, and then in other senses, I felt like, you know, it was maybe overshadowing like my work or other things that I was doing. I felt sort of pigeonholed. And even the record label I was at the time, they kept pushing me to do some kind of contrived Armstrong tribute. And I felt every time I step on the stage, I'm doing an Armstrong tribute. So I kind of strung them along and kind of used it as a way to leverage them letting me do other stuff. Yeah, the Armstrong album's coming, but let me do this other thing I'm trying to do. And I strung them along. I had a 5-album deal, and I didn't do Dear Lewis until my last album, you know. And I felt like I wanted to do a tribute. First of all, I wanted to pay a debt to his legacy and what he represented, but not just do the songs he did in the way he would do them, but to recognize and try to speak to the breadth of the things his legacy has spawned. You know, like, he is the progenitor of the idea of pop music. Like, that idea didn't even exist. Largely because we didn't have a medium by where it could exist. His new sound, his travels going from here to Chicago, with Chicago at that time in the early 20s was the metropolis of America. New Orleans was it before, and then he moved to New York. So he was like in all the central places to have maximum impact, and was in touch with that. And here was this new kid with a new sound whose meteoric rise coincided with the advent of a new form of technology in the phonograph, which allowed for everyone in the world basically to virtually hear the same piece of music at the same time and be impacted by the same piece of music at the same time. That did not exist before. So much like, I say, like Michael Jackson with the music video, he was this kid with a new sound, with a look, who could dance, that translates to this new medium. The same thing existed for Pops some 60 years before. So yeah, Michael Jackson is the king of pop, but Armstrong is the original king of pop. That idea did not exist before. So I don't care what you're listening to, everything from Rihanna to Katy Perry to Taylor Swift, every thing you hear on the radio, as far as the pop specter is concerned, owes a debt to Louis Armstrong. Everything, bad or good, doesn't matter. There is no pop music without him. And, you know, aptly named Pops, because he is he's the father of us all, bar none. I mean, he changed the quarter note. Like, he changed how 1, 2, 3, 4 feels. Like, a metronome has 4 beats, but he changed that. Like, I don't know of in recorded history of that happening before, and maybe it might not happen again. But certainly within our specter, like what we can see, he redefined whatever that was. So, you know, and even like his influences, like all due respect to like King Oliver, and much has been made about Bolden, which we don't really know how he sounded or whatever. We just, you know, we have to rely on legend and account and stories. But Louis Armstrong, we see where it is. We can see what music was before him. We could see what New York music sounded before him. We could see what Duke Ellington's band or Fletcher Henderson's band sounded before him. And like once he was there, like the difference, like doesn't happen too many times in a lifetime. So you can't overemphasize the importance of Armstrong.
Yeah. Related also to the fact that you mentioned Louis Armstrong can be considered the first pop music star. I'm aware that he also popular
or really like pop star period.
Pop star period.
I think like there were stars is like people who are known, but like that idea that a cultural medium that is influencing people, how they move, how they dress, how they dance, how they think, how they talk, all those things, the symbiosis of all those things packaged into one, like a cultural shift in an idea. Like he was the first representative of that idea.
Talk to us a little bit about his innovations as a vocalist, because he popularizes the vocalist as band leader.
I look at them as one and the same. Like, you know, he played as he sang, and he sang as he played. I mean, when you're playing a trumpet, you're essentially singing. The trumpet should be a microphone, ultimately. Like, sometimes we forget that because as instrumentalists, you get wrapped up in notes and chords and scales and stuff, but really you're singing. You're speaking a language. There should be lyrics, even if you're not singing them. I love this story of, I think it was Ben Webster, great tenor saxophonist, playing a song on his tenor saxophone. He's playing and then he stopped. It's like, and then somebody asked, hey, what happened? He was like, I forgot the words. Like, that's where we should all be. I don't care if you're singing or not. You should be conveying that narrative. The lyrics are there for a reason. So Armstrong was the embodiment, like what he does to like Stardust, what he did to the Tin Pan Alley, like, you think about what he did to that, like, it's just crazy. Like taking a song with do 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 do, and then he just like one note. Sometimes I'm, you know, like just that impacted Billie Holiday. Like you can hear, like she's pop. She's like that represent the feminine representative of what Louis Armstrong is, which impacted like Ella Fitzgerald and Sarah Vaughan. Like his tentacles are like they reach everywhere. Sinatra, like everybody, like nobody is who you think they are without Louis Armstrong. James Brown is not what he is without Louis Armstrong. Jimi Hendrix is not who he is without Louis Armstrong.
So knowing
Elton John is not who he is. Paul McCartney. Justin Bieber. Like, everybody. I don't care if you like them or not. I don't care if they even know they owe pops. They all need to pay a check. You know what I mean?
We know that they owe pops, but perhaps there has been a disconnect.
No, definitely.
In what popular music has owes to him in terms of the public discourse, mm-hmm. and Louis Armstrong being hailed as a jazz music hero. And I want to get into the conversation that you started in 2011, November 2011, with a blog post that you did called On Why Jazz Isn't Cool Anymore, and your thoughts on the word jazz and also Black American music.
Sure, sure. Well, I have to say I didn't start it because a conversation was in place. I just think we forgot. There's certainly people before me who were saying the same thing. Max Roach, Duke Ellington, Sidney Bechet, even in his book Treated Gentle, like when he talks about jazz, it's like, I don't even know what that means. We didn't use that word. Louis Armstrong himself said we didn't call it that. So this was something that was placed on the music by people who didn't create it, and is a term to sort of pigeonhole and commodify the music the way I see it. I mean, the first jazz recording was by the original Dixieland Jazz Band, which is like a farce on a lot of levels. Sorry if you like them, but they weren't original. They weren't the first. Dixieland, we know that's like tied to the colonist slave South. That's inappropriate. Jazz, originally it was spelled J-A-S-S, which was a hybridization of jackass. So they're making a mockery of the music the way I see it. They're making animal sounds. It's minstrelsy, basically. So we can say, you know, La Rocca wrote Tiger Rag and this, that, and the other. But these were white guys basically making a minstrelization of Black music that was a serious art form, as entertaining as it was. So jazz, to me, at its essence, that's what it is. We look at Al Jolson, the jazz singer, with Mammy with the black face and the white gloves. Like, that's jazz to me. We got the Jazz Age Jazz Party in New York, like, to this day. And it's basically like, you know, at the exclusion of Black culture. And to me, jazz at its essence, that's what it represents. Duke Ellington said that 80 years ago, and he tried to get Fletcher Henderson and a bunch of cast to like call it Negro music. Now, we don't use the term Negro anymore. Well, amongst each other, we do. But it's certainly not publicly appropriate to call a Black person a Negro, which is why I call it Black American music for several reasons, because I don't want to call it African American, because to me, like, I want to represent the fact that Black has to do with being raced in America. And that's a very important part of what this music is. Though it comes from Africa, it's a Black American invention. That idea didn't exist. Like, we can tie certain rhythms to Africa, even the swing rhythm or so forth. But like Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters, they didn't come out of the African experience. It was a Black American experience. So, and to me, that's what the music is. It's the most important part. To call it jazz, to me, allows these jazz programs that exist all over, not only this country, but the world, to deal with Charlie Parker, to deal with Duke Ellington, or to deal with Bill Evans or Chet Baker or whomever, and never really deal with the fact that Black people created this music. And that's not to say who can or can't play it, but that's actually the most important part, because this music was created because the Africans who were brought here during enslavement could not speak their languages. So they developed a new language in the blues and the field holler. Congo Square, which is one of the only places, if not the only place, where the enslaved Africans had a space to continue those traditions and to rebuild a lineage which white colonists sought to destroy. And unbeknownst to them, they just thought they were letting these Negroes do their thing on Sunday to keep them happy, but really they were building a link to Louis Armstrong, who would in some sense be our savior, like hundreds of years later. So that it's a language, and not only for the Black people, it speaks to their lineage, but all of us. Because as long, even as an oppressor, a white oppressor, like to oppress someone else, you yourself must be oppressed. So to enslave someone else, you yourself are enslaved. So this music really frees all of us. I don't care what color you are. And to take that away from the music almost reinstills a form of colonization. And I feel like jazz sort of recolonizes that which sought to be decolonized. So I don't call the music jazz. I feel like it's a colonist term. It's black music, black American music.
Well, from that same blog, and you can read all of Nicholas's writings on his website, nicholaspayton.com. And, you know, in the same way that Louis Armstrong wrote letters, you have written these letters that you shared with the public. And I want to read an excerpt of this, just a short...
Does it have profanity?
No. A short excerpt on that much longer piece entitled Why Jazz Isn't Cool Anymore, which debuted November 2011. I can't speak for anyone else, but I don't play jazz. Or maybe if you would like to read it.
Go ahead.
Okay. I play postmodern New Orleans music. Louis Armstrong and Danny Barker play traditional New Orleans music. Ellis Marsalis and James Black play modern New Orleans music. Kid Jordan and Clyde Kerr play avant-garde New Orleans music. Donald Harrison plays neoclassical New Orleans music. I play postmodern New Orleans music. I am part of a lineage. I am part of a bloodline. My ancestors didn't play jazz. They played traditional, modern, and avant-garde New Orleans music. I don't play jazz. I don't let others define who I am. I am a postmodern New Orleans musician. Any thoughts on that?
I don't know. Any thoughts?
We will have a Q&A. I want to get back to another tie, because we talked about the Dear Lewis album. And was that the first time that you and Dr. John worked together on a Louis Armstrong related project? Because I know one of his old Louis Armstrong project and some of the tours that he did, he called upon you to be the trumpet voice.
Yeah, and I also did a version of Dear Old Southland on his album This, That, and the Other. But yeah, I think it might have been the first time we worked together, actually. I know he was a bit apprehensive because to him I was kind of a wacko modern guy. And I told him my father was on it. He was like, oh, Walter's going to be there. And then he felt comfortable. Then he was like, okay, I know I can play now. It's going to be cool. So, yeah.
I know one of your favorite trumpeters, maybe, or artists, maybe your favorite is Miles Davis.
The favorite, yeah.
The favorite, okay. Yeah. There have been conversations, and you spoke to this, about Miles Davis maybe looking down at Louis Armstrong in a certain way. Of course,
did I say that?
No, you know, I was reading that earlier.
I don't know that to be true. I mean, from what I've read, I don't think he liked how Pops talked about like the bebop cats. But then, from what I understand, like, I don't think he liked the idea like as a whole and what it represented. And I get that because I agree. I don't like bebop as an idea as a whole, because I think it actually served to destroy a lot of the essence of what the music is. So, but when we assail bebop, we're not talking about like Charlie Parker or Dizzy Gillespie to me, which Pops was cool with Dizzy Gillespie. Pops actually, from what I understand, he loved Miles Ahead, the thing with Gil Evans. So he was listening the whole time. It's just a certain idea. He didn't like cats playing all these notes that didn't mean anything. Well, he says something, it sounds like somebody trying to play with a mouthful of hot rice or something, you know? I don't like that shit either. Like, when I go to gig and cats are like, I'm bored, and I'm a musician, so I can't imagine like what most people feel like. And I think that is maybe what he didn't appreciate, if I may say. That's my guess. But he was cool with the cats. In fact, Clark Terry used to tell me him and Dizzy, they used to go over to Pops' crib in Corona all the time and just hang out. And he loved them. He loved Dizzy. He got Dizzy. I don't think he got Bebop, but he got Dizzy. Because he saw himself in it. He's like, here's a cat. He's playing music at this high level, stretching the capabilities of the instrument, singing, very personable. He got that. He understood that. This very insular idea of, I'm going to try to play all these theoretical postulums that whatever, like, he didn't, that was not relatable in a social construct, I think. And to me, I think it served to decimate a large part of what the ancestors sought to instill and to support that point is like jazz itself, which to me is colonization, in its own specter became so colonized that Ornette had to free jazz in 1960. And I think that's what makes Ornette important, is because jazz music got away from its communal roots, its very conversational blues essence, in favor of this note-to-note, paint-by-numbers idea that people got from Charlie Parker. They got the wrong idea from Charlie Parker. Charlie Parker, at his essence, was a blues musician. And he was the first, perhaps, to develop a style that, therefore, could be codified and disseminated in a very, very structural, note-by-note way. But the idea a lot of musicians got was like a paint-by-numbers thing, where thereby you don't have to think anymore, and you could just see C7 on a piece of music and put these licks together and never have to think or respond rhythmically or melodically anymore. So jazz got in a very unhealthy space from which Ornette had to free it and bring it back to its primal, melodic, rhythmically inventive base. But to me, that's the part of what is in jazz that is intrinsically flawed. So someone is always going to have to be trying to free it or revive it. I just say, let jazz die and let it be black music.
Wow. On that note, we have a few minutes for questions from the audience. If anyone has any, and we ask that anyone who has a question speak into the microphone so that everyone can hear your question. I think I see one over here. Yes.
Hello.
Hi.
I was wondering if you could explain how Louis Armstrong changed the quarter note from da, 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 da. What did he change it to?
Ooh,
how did he change
it? Good question. Well, you know, you have a note, and you have one, two, three, four. There's also subdivisions within that note that are sort of invisible that affect it. There's a triplet within that quarter note. There's a duplet within that quarter note. There's a quadruplet. There's so many subdivisions within that one note. That's one thing. And the other thing which pops is like where you place it. So it's metrically everything in one quarter note. You have threes and twos and you have multiples of a lot of subdivisions within that, but where you put it. So try to pull this up real quick. Floating on it, you know. have that very, you take him out of it and it's just like that. That changes everything.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yes, I have a question about a man called Henry Payton. Oh. That was an accordion player in Storyville that Buddy Bolden played with before he had his own band. And I heard you mention that name in a radio interview that you were related to him. Can you explain that?
That's good. I can't explain it no more than that. As most black people, I'm going way back just with that I know that. And my distant cousin explained that to me. He's like, you know, you related to Henry Payton. And he was like a compadre of Buddy Bolden. I was like, no, I didn't know that, actually. So, yeah, that's about as much as I know. Mm.
Yeah. I have one question for you. I'm glad you just played that particular tune, because when you were talking about the people that were influenced by Louis Armstrong, the first thing that I went to was Willie Nelson, you know, and his, Starlight in Vermont. Anyway, I'm a charity hospital baby, but I grew up in San Antonio, so I'm looking at this guy, and I see that he had an influence, because I recall Mr. Barker talking to me about him, and this is a guy named, his stage name was Don Alward, but it was Alward Dominique, and who was a very good trumpet player in San Antonio. Are you familiar with his music?
I am not, no.
I think we had a question. Oh, there, okay. Feel like Phil Donahue. Anybody remember him?
Hello, thank you so much for your time today. I wanted to ask a question to maybe try to understand a little bit more of what you meant about the term jazz and the passing of jazz from generation to generation. As you're very well aware, when it comes to jazz itself as a music that is in the cultural space with younger peoples and people that are younger than 40, it's really not presenting itself as something that can last for the next 200 or 300 years.
Yeah.
And so how does that happen without codifying jazz to a certain extent? We create codification so that we can pass things on from one to another. So for instance, thinking of language, we write down a language. And so there are some tropes in there that are probably gonna be repeated over and over again. But at the end of the day, when we talk about something, we all know what we mean because we took the time to codify. And so I just wanted to understand a little bit more about what you've presented concerning using the term jazz to define New Orleans, postmodern, modern, et cetera, music, and what can be done as an industry to continue the legacy of this music so it doesn't die out like we're seeing in opera and classical and many other forms.
Mm-hmm. Well, to me, jazz is already dead. It's been dead. And it depends on what we mean by codifying something, right? Some people would say, whatever, it's like, hey, you can call a, is it black person, Negro, nigga, like what terms are appropriate, which ones are not, which ones are demoralizing, so forth. So yes, I do think there's value and merit in a tradition being passed on. But how it's passed on makes a difference. And I feel like our music is at its best. Yes, it can be written down and read, but notes on a page don't represent the feel. There's so much information missing. So I liken it to African drumming. How does one become the next village drummer? By hearing their elders and the rhythms being passed down in real time. You playing with other musicians. It's like when I played with Elvin Jones. Yeah, I studied Coltrane for years. I studied that sound, read books, listened to albums, transcribed the solos. But it wasn't until I worked with Elvin Jones, who was the drummer in that classic quartet, that I began to really understand the layers of what went into the music. First of all, I'm in touch with the person. And it's the person with their experiences that creates the music. The music doesn't create the music. So once you take the music out of its natural habitat and it becomes a matter of scholastics, it's already outside of its element and it's hard to survive. So I think black music and jazz in particular in that label, there are tons of jazz schools all over the world and they don't ever deal with black people. To me, that's a problem. And jazz allows for them to talk about Charlie Parker and Duke Ellington and never deal with the communities the music comes out of. We don't really see that much here because the music is still a very vibrant part of the cultural force. So what may be second nature to us here, where you can assemble a band, walk down any black neighborhood in the street, and everyone from the 2-year-old to the 92-year-old knows how to dance and move to this. I don't know any other place in the world that has that. Certainly not a relationship to like this line of black music in particular. So when you're outside of that and you live in some place, you know, like, no disrespect, Cincinnati or somewhere, and you're trying to learn to play this music and there's no vibrant scene, then how do you learn? Well, you go to the local university, all your teachers, maybe they've never played with the progenitors of this art form. They've never played with people associated to the lineage. Then how, therefore, can you teach it? But with jazz, you don't have to know anything. I can go to any university that has a jazz program and get accredited and validated by people who never played with anybody who played this music and become a jazz master and have a doctorate in jazz music. And I've never dealt with a black person in my life. So what does codification mean in that sense? So we have to look at, these are different worlds of thought. When we talk about black or African thought, and I use black and African interchangeably, versus European thought, Western classical thought, which I'm not saying one is better than the other, but they're two kind of different systems from what I understand. Like the Western philosophy comes more out of an intellectualism and a dualism and a split between like mind and soul or intuition, and maybe even down looking on the intuitive spiritual aspects. Whereas in African black thought, that is the primary focus, the intuitive spiritual sense and a sense of community as opposed to the individual. We have the individual, then we want to build walls to keep people out of a place they've lived for centuries. When we think communally, we see the ties in everybody and we want to bring everybody together. That's where I want to more focus on. Jazz separates. In my mind, black music brings together. And I think it's a matter of bringing together, you know, as opposed to separating.
Wow, profound statements. On that note, make some noise for our wonderful guests. Melissa Ray Weber and Grammy Award winner Nicholas Payton. And I'm sure Mr. Payton won't mind if you buy his music online. I'm sure he won't object to that at all. All right, well, have a brief announcement. And of course, our next, one of our hosts with the most will be coming up after this. But a brief announcement thanking our sponsors. I'm Don Lewis, and welcome once again to the annual Satchmo SummerFest presented by Chevron and the Hilton Satchmo Legacy Stage. This event is produced by French Quarter Festivals, Inc., a nonprofit organization showcasing New Orleans culture and heritage